let's begin.
Okay.
Okay. So first, what is RPA? So basically, like we all know that, you know, RPA is like, you know, every company is implementing RPA now and getting benefits. So what exactly is the RPA? Basic definition of RPA. So like, you know, say for example, as we know that suppose if you're eating a packet of chips, so that chips is you know, manufactured in a industry, in a plant. So that industry or a plant uses many manufacturing robots, which you know, process right from, you know, picking the ingredients to, you know, packing the whole lot and sending it to wholesalers. So that packet is an example of manufacturing industry. Here in software industry, RPA is nothing but a piece of code which just mimics the action done by human. So it's nothing but a, you know, set of codes instructed to perform actions which is actually performed by humans. So it so RPA is an application that we develop which allows our company or an organization to automate the business processes, the rules, the logic, to, you know, logic which is formed for a complex infrastructure. Okay, so it's in a simple way. Definition of RPA can be, RPA is nothing but a set of code which mimics the action of a human, which is, you know, yeah, that's it, action of a human. It's a piece of code. Okay, so the next is, who will be learning RPA? So anyone who is interested in RPA, anyone, any freshers or any graduate can, you know, make a career in an RPA. Existing automation engineers, testers can easily learn RPA. Any developer or any manager who is involved in operation teams, finance or operation teams, functional level knowledge they have, like any process manager who have the functional knowledge, not the technical knowledge is required, but they have the functional knowledge, can easily learn, can easily go for RPA. The next question comes is prerequisites. So what exactly is a prerequisites? Because, you know, right now many industries are implementing RPA. So the question comes, is coding background required? Is technical background required? So no, not to a certain extent. Prerequisites are, I mean, almost none. Simple, if, you know, if any managers or, you know, senior managers or any developers who has basic knowledge of IT or just know how the data flows from one application, from one application to application or, you know, org level business flow, can easily learn RPA. So in RPA, what exactly the topics will be covering? In RPA, there are two major components, that is control and client. So client is nothing but a machine which has automation anywhere installed. So like, say for example, in an organization, there would be 10 machines which has automation anyway client installed. And control room is a kind of a server which controls the operations, which controls the flow of the, you know, clients. So in as I've stated that, say for example, there are 10 machines which have automation anyway clients. So one machine can be made as a control room, which will check the operations activities being operated in those client machines. So these are two important components in automation anywhere. And under automation and under automation anywhere enterprise client, okay, we develop all the tasks. Okay, so task is nothing but a set of codes which comprises of all these commands, which we can see here in this PDF. Okay. Commands are nothing but, you know, a kind of built-in command or a tool which we just drag and drop in automation anyway interface. I'll be showing you the automation anyway interface. Okay, drag and drop, and simple inbuilt code is already, you know, developed, I mean built in, designed by the automation anyway software itself. Okay, so these are the commands. Okay, just to show the automation anywhere software. So this is the automation anywhere software. Okay, it's version 9. Okay, and this is how the automation anywhere interface looks like. As you can see here, there are the tasks, hierarchy of a task. Okay, so all the tasks can be saved under my task. You can also see exe files are there, scripts are there, and extra docs or any text or CSV file if you want to store can be saved in this location. Automation anywhere also provides excellent, you know, workflow it's kind of what we can say is if you want to automate entire complex infrastructure, task by task, subtask level, then it can be done using workflow tool. Schedules are there. If you want to set schedules of a task, if you want to run particular task in so-and-so time frame, so that can be done using schedule manager or schedules, which we can see over here. Or if you want, we can directly access from here as well. Okay. Triggers are there. Dynamic triggers which makes tasks easily run and execute at specific event. Say for example, if you want a task to run at when file gets created or when file gets modified, so at that time it's a specific complex trigger, dynamic event, which we can implement in order to make a task run at specific event. So that we can do it using trigger manager. Okay. The next comes is the designer. Okay, so this is the interface, how the automation anyway client looks like. The next is when we are developing the task, how the designer or the code interface looks like. So I'll go on to my task, and here there's a sample task. Okay, so actually my screen is short. I will just scroll down. So here you can see like there are many tasks over here. Okay, so one sample task I will take. Okay, say for example, download file. I'll just select this task, right click and click on edit. So the task editor will open. Okay. So this is how, you know, a task editor looks like. As I've, you know, here, as you can see in this PDF, there are many commands. So these all commands you will be able to see here in this window at left hand side. You can just scroll and see there are many commands. Under commands, there are many sub commands. Say for example, this is a clipboard command. So clipboard command contains three sub commands. So these three commands, sub commands will be used under clipboard. If you want to use clipboard command, so we can use these three sub commands. Okay. I will create a new task file, for instance, and just for a demo purpose, what I can do is I can, you know, show a simple task, showing a display message, hello, people or hello world. Okay. So this is a message box command. It's, you know, generic, which we show and display to everyone. It's a message box command, which does nothing but whatever if I type in here, it will display same message to user. Okay. And dynamic property of this message box command is if you want this message box to make it display till 10 seconds, so I can check this box and okay, it has only one integer limit property. So it will, so I can just make it 5, or say for example, I can make it 10. It doesn't take 2 digits. I'll just make this message box close till 9 seconds. Okay. And I will save it. Okay, I need to save this task. So it's very important to save this task prior running this task. Another thing is that we can password protect a task. So this feature is available in the licensed version. It's mentioned over here. It's available only in purchased version. So if you want, you can password protect your task in licensed version. And if you want, we can also create a shortcut of this task on our desktop. As of now, I don't want to create a shortcut. So I'll just save this. And I will just run. So in order to run, you can just click on this run button. So when I run, you will be able to view a runtime window. Okay. These contains two things. Okay. Line number and action. So in order to, you know, make the developer view where exactly the code is running, so it will show line 1 of 1 and action. So this is now a message box. Okay. Command. So in the under action, there was a message box written. So message box code has executed. Okay. So run once again. So here, it is, you know, it will close in 9 seconds. As I've mentioned, in 9 seconds, it will stay here. And then after 9 seconds, it will automatically close. Okay. And if you want to close immediately, there was a close now button as well. So you can immediately close. No need of waiting till 9 seconds. So this is how, you know, a short example of how automation anyway task editor looks like. At left hand side, you can see there are many commands. Under commands, there are various sub commands which we can use to create codes. Okay, A drag and drop interface is provided, GUI based, which is very user friendly. Anyone, you know, non-coding person can just, you know, just go there, simple design, just drag and drop this command and interface appears. Just need to put in all the required parameters or required inputs and just click on save. The code gets auto-generated like this message box. Okay. And here you can see two windows are there, like error view and variable manager, where we can dynamically add, edit or delete certain variables. Error view is provided. As we all know that it's very important to handle error, runtime error occurs, or you know, complex error occur while you're running any task. So in order to handle it very efficiently, we can implement the error handle, which is provided by automation anyway. It's over here. So if I say, for example, run this, okay, and I select action. So after meeting with an error, how do you want to proceed? Do you want to continue or do you want to stop the task? Say, for example, I want to continue. And what options you can, you know, perform when your task has met with an error? Do you want to take a snapshot? So say, for example, I just want to take a snapshot and I want to save it in my desktop with say name. Error one, say for example, JPG. I'm saving it here on my desktop. So suppose if error comes, then a snapshot will be saved under this location. Okay. So furthermore, options you can see, you can run another task. You can log data to a file. You can send email to specific persons stating that, knowing that, you know, that task has met with an error, you can take further action. And there's a variable assignment which we can set. Say for example, if we want to know that, you know, this task has met with an error, so we can create a variable, and if this task meets with an error, we can check this box and set that specific variable to, you know, status, like certain values or some status, because star status is already provided over here, fail or pass. If you want it, you can also save it in another variable. A counter flag you can set and make this to false value if this task meets with an error, and vice versa. Okay, and accordingly you can save it. Okay. See, the code gets created. Okay, and similarly you can see the error handle over here appears. So in a task there can be multiple error handlers, and to efficiently view and handle and, you know, code design and develop, we can directly go over to this window and modify the error view as well. Okay, and for advanced user, those who want to debug and, you know, want to kind of do the development from their own instead of using the recorders, can easily go for enable debugging command and accordingly, you know, check if a task has met with an error, was the value stored in a variable, can easily do a debugging part. When we enable debugging, you will be see a variable watch window wherein we can add windows, add variables and see what value comes in the runtime. Okay, so definitely we'll be covering this in our course module. And the basic part we have covered, and all these are, you know, high level app commands are there. Email automation, terminal emulator, which is used for all the mainframe application automation. Image recognition is there. If we want to recognize an image, if we want to get or capture image within an image, so we use image recognition. And this is another type of command, optical character recognition, OCR. If you want to capture character within an image, so at that time we use OCR. So all these commands, sub-commands comprises a task, and this task then becomes, you know, a code or a task files, ATMX files, which then gets, you know, combined to create a workflow and execute complex business processes.